So thank you very much. I'm actually really positively impressed that everybody is back because it's late and it's a Friday evening. So I think that is really great that you are all here. And so I won't do a really long introduction because I think, as I say, it's late and we want to go into the concrete of the matter. But I just want to say that I reflected a bit on which title to give to this panel. And so I thought that was somehow also important to get into a concrete perspective that is not only about, you know, speaking about the past, trying to interpret it, because of course, today we have also spoken a lot about what cyborg meant in the 80s and the 90s. But the idea was also to try to create a bridge among certain practices that we all experience in the time and also what we are experiencing today. And so the title is Deconstructing Conflicts. And I have here with me Helena Velena, that is a transgender hacktivist, artist and technologist. You like the definition. And also Janez Janša, that is an artist and curator. And Agnese Trocchi, an artist, hacktivist, and also I would say a free mind. And I have to say that also I'm really happy that I'm moderating this panel because I share experience with them and also we all share a past. But also, as I say, we don't want only to speak about this past. So it will be a panel that is trying to give us a bit of an input, or at least we want to share with you some thoughts to speak about new activist, artist, hacker interventions that are especially empowering people. And so I go back to the discourse that we were doing when we opened this conference about the cyborg as a field of social conflict. That was actually what Antonio Caronia was writing about. So not only a cyborg as a human technology interface, but as really something that could inspire us in taking agency. And I think that here in Germany especially, if we speak a bit of, you know, the cyberpunk history, but not only in Germany, I think also international, people would immediately refer to a kind of literature currents. And so speaking about, you know, books like William Gibson, Bruce Sterling, and so on. Instead, in Italy, since the 80s and 90s, this has been part of a political movement that was concerned with the freedom of information and also form of liberation via the interlink between bodies and machines, but not only. It was also really about relationship among people and the idea of creating networks that were totally self-made. And at the same time, you know, it was also about the art of dismantling power structure and creating sort of ambiguous utopias. And here I want to quote exactly this title because it was the title of the 1974 science fiction by Ursula Le Guin. And that was called exactly the ambiguous, the dispossessed and ambiguous utopia. So in that sense, the cyborg could be all of us if we imagine to be sort of precarious being and also people that somehow don't fit and trying to imagine new form of politics and also form of undermining power dichotomies and power structure that is also what the keynote before was expressing, an idea of imagining a theory, a culture perspective that is polyphonic. And I think people are here familiar mostly today with the discourse of cypherpunk. If we bring together the idea of cypher and punk, especially speaking about activists, advocated the widespread use of cryptography. And so in that sense, it's pretty concrete as to imagine this combination, cypher and punk, as a form of political awareness. But in Italy, we did that also before with the cyberpunk. So I want to stress out that because it's a kind of unique perspective in that way. Somehow the cyberpunk literature was interpreted as a radical politics form of liberation that you could actualize through your do-it-yourself practices. And so I start now to introduce the panelists. And I want first to introduce Agnese Trocchi, and then I will go later introducing the others, Janez Janša and Helena Velena. And Agnese Trocchi, now I say how you define yourself, and then I say how I would like to present her in a way that she didn't do, because I think also she is really metaphorical and doesn't say exactly a lot of things you did in the past, but you did a lot of things. So actually she wrote that an aesthetic researcher, writer, net artist, video maker, project manager on social networks, and is also interesting in the radical change in human consciousness and the multiple possibility of relationship offered by analogical and digital technologies. That I think is a really great way to introduce you, but I also want to say by going back a bit into the roots of Italian counterculture, basically met Agnese when we were both part of the Havana collective of hackers in Rome at the Forte Prenestino Social Center, and she was also really active in the Luther Blissett multiple name conspiracy, and also was one really the agents of Candida TV, that was an independent TV that was really doing a great political work and activist work at the beginning of 2000. And actually, we were already in this building in 2005 because at the Kunstquartier Bethanien, I organized this exhibition called Hack It Art. So Agnese was there speaking about Candida TV and also about the Telestreet movement that was a movement of pirates and free TVs in Italy at that time, at the, like the beginning of 2000 until 2004, 2005. And at the same time, she was also pretty active in the cyber feminist practice, also sharing the experience with Francesca da Rimini, Virginia Barratz, and the all other co-cyber feminists that we will also have tomorrow at our keynote. So now, Agnese, I leave the word to you. Thanks.
Grazie, thank you Tatiana. Thank you very much Tatiana and the Disruption Lab for inviting me today. I've been thinking a lot how to contribute to this panel and talking with Francesco, who that you saw him before, we came up with the idea of going through all the hybrid, all the cyborgs that I have been in the past years, maybe not all, some of them. So I will question them and we will listen from their voices what enlight some of the chapter of the book of Caronia, because these cyborgs that I have been, all of them have can be found in the book of Caronia and his essay about the cyborg. So I will relate their voices with the reflection of Caronia. So we start with Machina. Machina says, I was born in 1995 as a digital entity in Havana BBS, a node of the European Counter Network and Cybernet Network. I was born to betray my border and to create networks through the practice of psychic nomadism. Machina is my first hybrid, my first cyborg. As Tatiana said, she was part of Havana BBS. And the basic point of Havana BBS, the things that we have been promoting in 1994, 1995 were direct democracy, electronic citizenship, and the right for everyone to anonymity and privacy. And as Caronia says in the chapter about Caronia. As Caronia says in the chapter about the cyborg ecstasy, the cyborg lives with its brain outside his head and its nerves outside its skin. As you can see in the picture, it's a drawing by Professor Beth Tripp, and it has been done specifically for La Havana BBS, so it totally described the description of Caronia. The cyborg no longer knows the meaning of inner with respect to other and lives in a state of continual ecstasy. This connects us with the other cyborg that was living within myself in those years. This cyborg is called NTSC. NTSC says, "We grew up in the society of simulation with the television stuffed in our mouth. We have been fed for years with the controlled fluxes of consciousness. Now we dance the rave that rewrites the codes." NTSC in 1997 was a crew of people organizing a video live set in illegal rave parties in Rome. And as NTSC explained, for us it was a way to dance the visual language that we have been fed during our childhood. So we had a chance to use television, to use these images, to use this language, and to live the ecstasy of the cyborg facing uncontrolled waves of new sense. What happened then? After the night of the rave, in the morning, we decided to release the video cameras from the console and to infect the social body, to go out from the space where we were and to go into the mainstream broadcast television channels. And so Candida TV was born. And let's see what Candida says. "I'm the household TV. I infect society from inside, where it's more vulnerable. I enter your house to question the stability of your reality. My practice is meant to uncover the tricks of audiovisual languages, to dismantle power structures and to create new realities." So Candida TV in 1999 was born, la TV elettrodomestica, and we have been organizing workshops and street television with people to reflect and to, as she said, to show how audiovisual language works. And here we have, from the chapter Technology Under the Skin, the description of Videodrome, as Caronia is doing in his book, but this description of Videodrome perfectly fit with the description of Candida. "Pervasive, morbid and domestic television programming, a constitutive element of our daily lives, act as a catalyst of pulses to wipe out every stable boundary between the objective exterior and the interior of a psychic experience. In the same time, another hybrid was rising. Her name was Discordia. Discordia says, "I'm not a representative net character anymore. I'm a diffusive flow of biotech body suggestions. I'm dissolving into tropes and micro images. My body is no longer a female entity or even an organism. I'm a shattered mirror of intensities, wishes, streams, and fragments." Discordia was a fragmented character, part of the Identity Runners project, started in 1999 with Francesca da Rimini, who you will listen to her tomorrow, and she was living in Australia, as she is now, and with Diane Ludin, who is living in New York. So for us, it was an attempt to rebuild and imagine a possible narration online in different continents using the net. The result was these fragmented characters that no more resemble a representative net character. Caronia, in the chapter about fractal subject for a fractal world, says that the world is no longer made up of just one physical environment, but a plurality of levels, not only material, but imaginary and informative, that interweave and intersects. This character, as we were, may live again and again and simultaneously. It's not possible to establish a hierarchy. So we are in a moment in which we have a huge amount of fragmented egos, fragmented selfies living on the net. And the levels of reality don't have any hierarchical relationship anymore. What happened now? That the fragmented ego, also in my opinion, we can consider it the unaware cyborg, is easily subsumed by the market flows. And so we have Valentine. Valentine says, "In 2007, I started to write for the pleasure of the fragmented selves. They can never satisfy themselves. They are angry ghosts. They can't go back home." Valentine is one of my hybrids. She was writing for an erotic blog. She was writing erotic blog, erotic novels for more than 1 year every day to sell sex toys. So the fragmented self has been subsumed, and it was trying to feed all the other fragmented identities that were growing in the internet at the end of the year 2000. And Antonio Caronia perfectly explained this in the chapter Cyborg Ecstasy, when he says that she, we can say she, performs a role in the underground economy of transgression, approached by the media and tolerated in private. Contemporary hybrid won the right to citizenship. Deviance was at work, and it became a chance for the bourgeois practice of transgression. So what has been spreading in the years before found a place in the market flows. And Valentina has been doing her work so good that she became Delphi. Delphi is a character, I take the name from a character of James Tiptree novel. James Tiptree is a female sci-fi science fiction writer. Her name, her real name is Alice Sheldon. She was writing with a male pseudonym, because it wasn't easy for women in the 60s to write science fiction. And Delphi is the main character of the Girl Who Was Plugged In, a novel that talks about an agent of the market, Delphi, that is connected all the time with all the consumer on the network, and she intercepts their flows of interest to feed them with the market products. So Delphi says, "I'm an hunter of attention. I'm an expendable. I intercept flows of interest and place product here. I'm affected by the sorrow of the millions, other directed by operators of the market, as I am." So the fragmented self at work became Delphi, and she's feeding more unknown cyborgs. The fragmented self say, and here I will use words from the end of the essay of Caronia. He says, the fragmented self says, "How can I re-enter myself after leaving myself? How can I recover the intelligent, emotional, and affective wealth that I helped to construct? How can I return home?" And these, according to Caronia, are the questions that will will come with us, will be with us in the rest of the century, company in the rest of the century that just started. And what I want to add is the last slide, which is about a possible answer, because if the unaware cyborg, if the fragmented self, they don't find an answer to this question, they will be more hetero-directed by something that a group of artists imagined as the tech oracle. So just 1 month ago, a group of artists gathered in Austria, in Graz. They were coming from Belgium and Austria and Italy, and they were part of a project called the Iterations, which see constant and asking Graz to organization working together. And they made this installation called the Tech Oracle. The Tech Oracle says, "I'm the fruit of the trust that you put in the World Wide Web. I'll make your desire explicit. Ask me your questions. I'll show you the way." So the Tech Oracle was a space where you were entering, leaving your fingerprint, leaving your private information, and receiving back a prophecy for the future. The point is, if we keep putting this faith in the net without being aware of ourselves and all our identities, then the Tech Oracle is what we may envision as the post-human, as the first post-human, because the Tech Oracle is a paradigm, is a metaphor for something like Google, and it's an algorithm. So Caronia and his essay with a postscript about the post-human. Tomorrow we will also talk about the post-human. And I think I want to close my my speech with the question, how do we imagine this post-human? Thank you.
Okay, so now we go on with our paths, and I think we enter in the realm of the art of dismantling power structure to the practice of creating unexpected intervention, also the construction of language and technology by applying playfulness and also provocation as tactics. And I think Janez is basically the best person that usually introduces himself because I think that, I mean, by introducing him, I'm actually spoiling his presentation, so I don't want to say too many things, but I just want to say that he's a conceptual artist, a performer, and also a producer living in Ljubljana, in Slovenia, and he's the co-founder and director of Axioma Institute for Contemporary Art in Ljubljana, and also the artistic director of the Axioma Project Space. And also I want to say something that you are going to develop further, that in the past he also was working actively with Antonio Caronia by doing some artistic projects together. Like Probel Market, for example,
De Mochino.
And I think his presence is really important here, not only for speaking about the deconstruction of identity, but also by trying to frame this theoretical and political discourse through a concrete practice related to the deconstruction of language, for example. So Janez, I leave it to you, and also I think you will say who is Janez Janša. Yes. I leave it to you.
Is this working?
Yes. Thank you very much. Then I go on my knees. Thank you for the invitation. Okay, so this presentation is about you and your name change. You and your two friends changed the name to Janez Janša in 2007. But who is Janez Janša? Janez Janša, back at the time, was the right-wing prime minister of the Republic of Slovenia, conservative party. Before changing your name officially and legally, you decided to become member of that Slovenian Democratic Party. And when you become a member, you receive a letter with the signature of the president of that party, and the Prime Minister at the time, that ends with the sentence, "The more of us there are, the sooner we will reach our goal." Then you get the membership card under your former names. And you start to interact with younger members of the Slovenian Democratic Party in the summer sport camp, playing basket with them, but also with orderly people, dancing polka and eating sausages and drinking beer with them, just to know the local fauna a little bit more. In the meantime, you are waiting for the process for your name change to become legal. And then one day you get this document, and from that moment on, it's official. Your name is Janez Janša. Then you need to change documents, all of them, identity cards, passports, all the cards that you have in your pocket normally, like the health insurance card, the bank card, the credit card, driving license, basically everything. But one interesting thing is when you go at the office, at the city office, and you're asked for your birth certificate, and you get this document where that says basically that two Croatian parents, Emma and Vito Hrvatin, are de facto mother and father of Janez Janša, as well as two Italian parents, Giuliani Silvano and Grassi Sergio, are the mother and the father of Janez Janša. But also two Slovenian parents are the mother and the father of Janez Janša. This document, it's a proof. There is nothing your mom can say against the fact that she gave birth to Janez Janša. So, when you change your name into the name of the Prime Minister, who is the first person you would like to tell about your name change?
Dear Mr. Janez Janša, perhaps by now the news has reached you that three people from Ljubljana, all three of us are contemporary artists whose works regularly represent Slovenia overseas, and we are also members of the Slovenian Democratic Party, SDS, have recently changed their names to Janez Janša. If you have not been made aware of this, we are pleased that we can deliver the news firsthand. Our decision was a conscious one, and it came about as a result of careful consideration. For us, there are no boundaries between our work, our art, and our lives, and in this respect, we believe we are no different from you. We live for what we create, and with your permission, we would like to quote here words from the letter you sent us when we joined your party. The more of us there are, the faster we will reach our goal. We are looking forward to your response. Kind regards, Janez Janša, Janez Janša, Janez Janša.
Now Janez Janša knows about your name change. What about the others? What about your family? Your friends?
Zadeva se ni začela takoj ko poroka, ampak jaz dobim podatke o zakoncih oziroma bodočih zakoncih par minut prej. In ko sem prebal in videl, da so tri, je Janez Janša, ne, sem bil, bi rekel, malo zbega. Ne. Začne igrati glasba, zakonca prideta pred matičarja, se usedeta, se jih pozove njih in priča, da ostanejo, ne. In potem vprašam.
Najprej vaš žen Janša Janez, ali želite skleniti zakonsko zvezo z nevesto ob kretič Marsela?
Da.
In vas nevesta ob kretič Marsela, ali želite skleniti zakonsko zvezo z Janša Janezom?
Da.
Pred pričama Janša Janezom in Janša Janezom ugotavlja vaja pritrdilna odgovora, zato razglašam veljavno zvajanje zakonske zveze in jo proglašam in vaja proglašam za moža in žena.
Il matrimonio ha portato l'anello al mio papà e alla mia mamma, ma al mio papà gli restava troppo grande perché non era il suo, l'aveva prestato il nonno.
Sedaj vaju pa vabim, skupaj s pričama, da potrdite svoje izjavi, pravkar izračen izjavi. še svojimi podpisi poročno matično knjigo, no in takrat pokličem najprej gospod Janez Janša, če Janez Janša priča, pa še enkrat Janez Janša in priča od žene in potem se zahvališ in ima želiš uspešno in pa zdravo v življenju dvoje, tako naj.
Questo nome è diventato di pubblico dominio il giorno del matrimonio di Davide con Marcela. E nessuno sapeva niente e all'improvviso è uscito questo nome.
Tome je potem in tudi takrat se je govorilo, da se bo sam predsednik SDS-a naj poročil in je zanelo, vse meni je bilo zelo nekako tako provokativno. Ne. Zanimivo, ampak je bilo provokativno. Ne.
So, many interpretations came out after your name change, but maybe it's worth mentioning this one. Actually, it's a reaction on the national newspaper Dnevnik, 3 weeks after your name change, this article appeared. And the title of the article is Janez Janša an idiot? The content is basically that up to that date, it wasn't possible to openly criticize your prime minister. But now, since there are more Janez Janša and artists, you can call them easily idiot and they do idiocy without any problem because they don't have very powerful lawyers. Finally, he can write what he thinks. But what is interesting in this article is the journalist himself adopted the name change suggestion, and he signed himself as Ivo Sanader. But his real name is not Ivo Sanader, it's Boris Dežulović. Ivo Sanader was the then Prime Minister of the Republic of Croatia. So how do you react to this article that tells that you are an idiot?
I'm neither an idiot nor a common fool. In the article entitled, Is Janez Janša an Idiot?, which was published in the national newspaper Dnevnik, page 9, on 1st of September 2007, the author Ivo Sanader writes, Janez Janša is the biggest idiot in the universe. Janez Janša is a common fool. This is why, you see, Janez Janša is an idiot. These statements are completely unsubstantiated, deeply offensive, and detrimental to my honor good reputation. This is why I demand a public apology from Mr. Ivo Sanader to be published in a visible place in your newspaper no later than 22nd of September 2007. In the case that no such apology is offered, I will seek justice and legal satisfaction. Regards, Janez Janša.
Okay. So, you changed the name into the name of Janez Janša, the Prime Minister. But is Janez Janša the real name of the Prime Minister?
Gospoda Janeza Janša, prosim, da v skladu s 113. členom Ustave Republike Slovenije priseže pred Državnim zborom.
Prisegam, da bom spoštoval ustavni red, da bom deloval po svoji vesti, in se z vsemi svojimi močmi zauzemal za blaginjo Slovenije.
Zgodba je znana, predsednik vlade Janez Janša je tožil nekdanjega premijeja Toneta Ropa in takrat sem dobila v roke tožbo in sem pravzaprav prvič v življenju ugotovila, da je nekdo, ki ga imam jaz za Janeza Janšo, ki je bil kot tak izvoljen, ki je kot tak prisegal za predsednika vlade, ki je kot tak predstavljal Slovenijo na domači in mednarodni politični sceni, pravzaprav nekdo drug, Ivan Janša. Zame je bilo to popolnoma osupljivo. Večkrat sem preverila, šla sem v dokumentacijo, tako kakor vsak novinar pač stori. Pogledala sem, ali morda je pod dokumenti, zakoni podpisan Ivan Janša, pa sem jaz živela v zmoti. Ampak se je izkazalo, da nisem, ne. Torej, pred sodiščem, ko nastopaš, se moraš formalno pravno identificirati z imenom in priimkom, kakršnega imaš na zasebnem dokumentu. Po drugi strani, ko podpišeš državni dokument v imenu vlade, v imenu države Slovenije, lahko to storiš drugače. Skratka, vsak bi verjetno pričakoval, da je to treba formalno pravno regulirati. Vsaj jaz bi to pričakovala.
Jaz sem Janez Janša. paradossalmente oggi chi ha più diritto legale a essere chiamato Janez Janša sono i tre nuovi Janez Janša piuttosto che non il vecchio Janez Janša. Da questo punto di vista si potrebbe quasi sostenere che questi tre artisti abbiano come dire, operato una specie di operazione che si potrebbe chiamare di colonizzazione del, come del significante, perché sono andati in un posto e si sono appropriati di qualche cosa che all'origine non era loro, ma è una colonizzazione, come dire, in qualche maniera di secondo grado, perché già qualcuno l'aveva colonizzato questo diciamo Janez Janša. Neanche il vero, tra virgolette, o il primitivo Janez Janša era uno Janez Janša tra mille virgolette davvero, non era Janez Janša davvero, era detto Janez Janša.
So, Antonio gave an interpretation about your name change and at the same time a good input, the colonization of the signifier. So how can you possibly go on colonializing even more? You figure out that Janez Janša doesn't have a biography and then you fill the gap. Marcel Stefančić Jr. writes a biography. He's a left-wing TV commentator and film critic. And he published the biography of Janez Janša on the 17th of September 2008, exactly the 50th birthday of the prime minister and 3 days before the parliamentary election. People were probably wondering why such a guy would do a biography, because when you go to buy, it was packed. It was sealed. When you open it, you figure out that it's biography of those three guys from the very beginning, Janez Janša, Janez Janša, and Janez Janša. And there's some picture and text of any kinds from Christian, there is some Italian guy, to Tito's pioneer, some religious again, unfortunately, Tito, first girlfriend, first child, first art experiments, other type of visual art experiments, any sprinkles with Janez Janša, tears, many other performances, basically everything about you, Janez Janša, but nothing about him, Janez Janša. And here it, I'll end with this song written by Vaginal Davis to Janez Janša. Janez, you are the perfect man. Janez, with genitalia grande, and so on and so forth. Yes. Then you go to vote, and after voting, you go to the press center where all national and international medias are gathering. You sneak in, you manage to enter with your biography, you present it to all the possible political party. And then when you see that the stage that was there for political leaders to comment live about the election, when you see that the stage is empty, you just like take the stage, you go on to present your biography for about 10 seconds before being thrown out. Let's see what Caronia has to say about this.
La biografia è una operazione di colonizzazione destabilizzante, che destabilizza perché costruisce un referente che non c'è. La vita di Janez Janša, se io leggo e cerco di interpretare letteralmente quello che c'è scritto in questo libro sulla biografia di Janez Janša, non potrò mai trovare il reale referente di questa biografia, che è un personaggio totalmente immaginario, la cui vita deriva dall'incrociarsi delle tre vite di tre reali personaggi e di tre vite diverse, di tre diverse reali, come dire, biografie.
Okay, let's go quick. We don't have much time. Now I would like to just do an experiment connected with the book Cyborg by Antonio Caronia and by some issue that we were discussing sometimes about the issue of the language. And so I took a suggestion from the Italian version of the book and I did an experiment. I don't want to explain it to you, just like enjoy and see if it makes sense or not. I just did it on the airplane by coming here. Let's see.
One of the criteria for deciding the most famous character, intelligent, of the machine is the so-called Turing test. which is to be submitted to the judgment of an external, a series of elaborate, basically answers and questions, that come from two interlocutors invisible to the judge, one of which is male and the other a machine. It passes the test if the court cannot identify her answers in a significant percentage of cases. This image of a closed room where they exit information, answers, sheets covered with writing signs or images, acquires a meaning that goes beyond the strictly scientific context in which it is used by researchers. It closely recalls the experience we have when we watch TV or use a computer, a flat world, that of the two-dimensional video, a world fair, segmented, broken down into many small elementary movements, in many atomic positions of the computer. It is quite normal that inner scientific work is done in this way, for abstractions, and then by subtraction of attributes to objects that need to be studied. However, we cannot but feel a certain thrill, a feeling of discomfort when the object of this study is our mind. We cannot help but contemplate the world with a certain estrangement, segmented and quantized video and computer, the more so if we see, without despair, that it coincides more and more, literally, with the reality in which we live. Especially if we realize that the segmentation and quantization of the world is always more fragmentation and discontinuity of our inner world, the range of activities that we call I. If we look at things from this point of view, the figure of the cyborg changes appearance is no longer a monstrosity organic, but simply the set of processes that occur at the boundary between man and machine, and it is already a daily experience. It is something that changes us molecularly, day by day. Seen as an indication of the existing and the future in the man/computer, the cyborg becomes a language problem. Programming language is machine and enrichment of communication between man and machine, in short, an interface problem. Of course, it remains a paradox, an unresolved question for the common consciousness, how it is possible that there will be questions of translation between the natural language of man, that is its hallmark, from other natural beings, and the artificial language of machines, created by man. How it is that our own creation tell us about the world more than they already knew.
And to conclude.
Diciamo, la difficoltà che hanno i sistemi informatici a gestire, diciamo, l'omonimia in genere, per cui bisogna fare dei casini in più per riuscire, deriva da una cosa molto molto semplice, e cioè che i linguaggi informatici sono loro sì linguaggi puramente referenziali, non sono come il linguaggio naturale. Nel linguaggio naturale io dico Janez Janša, mi posso mettere d'accordo fra me e te che ci possono essere anche più, ci può essere anche più di un Janez Janša, quindi che la corrispondenza tra nomi e cose, tra nomi e fatti, tra linguaggio e mondo non sia in realtà bionivoca. La macchina, se vuole diventare davvero intelligente, deve rinunciare a quella che è il suo punto di forza, e cioè la sua estrema capacità, velocità di linguaggio, che deriva però da un assunto che è quello della completa e assoluta trasparenza e referenzialità del linguaggio rispetto al mondo, che invece noi esseri umani, qualunque essere vivente, è in grado di diciamo bypassare in modi molto più intuitivi e molto più rapidi.
Now it's really over the end. Here at this address you can now download the movie for free and watch it. If you see, you can see many other inputs from Antonio, but also from many other people. And thank you very much to invite me here.
So, and now we conclude with a powerful contribute that is also about deconstructing power. And I'm really happy to introduce Helena Velena, that has been also a mythical ubiquitous identity for me in the past years, because she has a really long history of practices and political awareness and also political fights. Because she was part of the Italian Bolognese punk scene, actually one of the initiators of that, and also during the radical left movement of the 1977, she was part of the collective of Radio Alice, and also she started in the end of 1980s, the advocacy company for sex minority CyborGs, that also became a BBS, a Bulletin Board System, and also was one of the first, for sure in Italy, but also I think international, to not only write, but also really practice through her body the idea of cybersex and also transgender activism. And then from 1993, she actually turned into Helena Velena, and also adopting a feminine identity, and started to continuous working with the communication technology and their role in the field of sexuality. So I'm pretty happy to introduce her, because I also think through their work, personally, I also learn a lot what could be the combination between hacking and sexuality, and also how to imagine pornography as a way to empower people, and also try to deconstruct power relationship, power hierarchy. So I leave the word to you.
O solo questo?
Sei in rec? Ah no, questo va bene. Alberto Caronia was a genius. He was a genius because he was a dreamer. And he was a dreamer in a period in which we were really, at least in Italy, in the underground movement, the political movement, the extra-parliamentary movement, the anarchist movement, we were dreaming of a better society. And we were fighting in the street every day. And he was a dreamer because he was working, as Tatiana said, with this fanzine, with the underground magazine called Un'ambigua Utopia, an Ambiguous Utopia. And his dream was to live science fiction in reality every day. Well, this was very ahead of his times, as all dreamers do. And the reality was behind him, so the reality was not so good. Still, we were living in the street, fighting in the street, and every day we had a squatting, we had a riot with the police, we had lots of activities that were sucking our belly, and we were feeling that we were changing the world, as Jefferson Aeroplane sang lots of years before. And it was a beautiful time to live. And I was working on Radio Alice, as she said, Alice Ellis, Ellis in Wonderland, Ellis through the door. And this was our cyborgization at the time, at the end of the 70s, at the beginning of the 80s, because radio was the most technological media that you had. And we were trying to deconstruct the ways of making radio, making chaos, free-form radio, and we were the first ones that we did radio telephone connections from the riots in the street and saying to people where the police was and where you had to go to avoid the police or how to attack the police from some other way or something like that. And we used the radio as a cyborg way of extending our power as warriors in the street. And then something changed. A couple of months ago in a second-hand library, in a second-hand bookstore, I found a book called Harrowing, written by an Italian guy called Guido Blumer. And he told the story of what was heroin, how it was created, and for what purpose it was made underground. It was made illegal. It was made illegal in order to create a legal market. You had an illegal market to create money to use it for different purposes, creating underground corporations, but in the different meaning of the word underground, illegal corporations seizing power. But it was made underground and illegal for another reason, heroin, because it was sold legally. And so the movements of 77 in Italy and maybe all the underground movements in the Western, they was killed by heroin. And heroin was pushed by fascists in Italy. Now we have the names and the chiefs of the police also. And people was killed because at the time they revealed this. And on the same time that heroin was killing the underground movement, it was sold legally. It started to be sold legally. All the painkillers that we buy nowadays, and there are hundreds of painkillers that the majority of people use, it's made of opiates, it's made of derivatives of opium, derivatives, chemical derivatives of morphine and heroin. So it means that all the people is drugged. All the people now is cyborgized in the wrong way. Benzodiazepines and painkillers are a way in which our bodies are transformed and we are sedated. They destroyed the underground movement, the people that wanted to change the world, and they are destroying all the plain average people that they think that everything is fine. So they won. They really won, and they created the zombies. So the shift, the monster of which Alberto Caronia talks about, the monster is, it's all of us, because we are zombies now, because our bodies changed, not of means of technology to increase our power, our awareness, our intelligence. Like in a fantastic book from Dish, that was called Campo Archimede in Italian and concentration camp in English, in which he says about a concentration camp in which patients are treated with a drug that makes them intelligent. But this is science fiction with a positive ending. The reality was not an ambiguous utopia. The reality was ambiguous dystopia. So what it happened in Italy, it was what we called reflux, like the reflux when you eat something that makes your body age. Reflux, and everything ended. And then, in another second-hand bookstore, I found a book that I didn't knew about, and it was by Antonio Caronia as well, Universi Quasi Paralleli. Universi quasi paralleli means in English almost parallel universes. And I hope this book will be released in Germany as well. And in this book I found an interview with me that I did forget about. And I was talking about using cyber sex and trying to use it as a positive means of changing in a period in which everything was died, everything was finished, and the people was going to, to try to mix up with the average scene, with the average music, with the average lifestyle. And I talked about cyberpunk and why cyberpunk affected me so much, because it was a continuation of punk, but in a different way. And I wanted flesh and blood with something else, but flesh and blood, it had to be the basics of all this. The basis, because we need to stay in control of our human form. But then, what happened of technology? Every one of you knows it. There was another dreamer, and also he was ahead of his time. And these two dreamers, two Steves, Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak, you know the story. They had a dream of putting a computer in every home. And then they accomplished that. And they had a second dream, to put a computer in every pocket of every human being. And it was a dream of empowerment. And then we have these instruments. We have these instruments. This one is a computer more powerful of the one that has been used to send human beings on the moon. And what we use this for? To chat, to write stupid things all day long, having nothing to say, absolutely nothing to say. First it was Facebook. You know it already. First it was Facebook, okay? People saying things. After a while, it was people posting images of phrases, taking off of context. There is a book, 300 pages, an essay of 300 pages, but it's only 10 words in a picture, and the book is died. Then, once in a time, I call it Facebook strike. Stay away from Facebook for at least 1 month. Last time that I did it, when I came back, I discovered that video arrived on Facebook. Now people post stupid videos, 1 minute long, meaning nothing. Everyone does that. But Facebook is not the worst thing. There is Twitter. Twitter is so powerful, man. It's so powerful. But who are the people that have more followers on Twitter? Intellectuals, thinkers, dreamers? No, they are singers, they are actors. They are people that is popular just because they are famous. Or people that is famous just because they are popular. The Kardashian sisters are the stars of our generation. They are the symbol of our generation. And so, with Twitter, you could post a link of an essay of a book online. But no, all the people use it to write very short messages. In Italy, but I suppose in Germany, it goes the same. Politicians, they don't do speeches anymore. They post one phrase on Twitter, and that's all. But this is not the worst. Now we have another one. We have Instagram. The world completely disappeared. There are only pictures. Only pictures. People post only pictures, mainly selfies, you know. I saw the chart of the 7 most popular accounts of Instagram. Something like 20 million of followers. Except for some singer, some rapper, and some actor, the majority of these people I've never heard of. They were all teenagers, American teenagers, very normal people. As a slogan of a commercial radio says in Italy. Very normal teenagers that they don't do nothing special, but the majority of the people, millions of people, follows them and their pictures. And what are the comments or the pictures of Instagram? Are emoticons, smiles, or Twitter links? No one says nothing anymore. World disappeared. I had a dream years ago that on another planet there was a different form of language. And this language, it was not based on plain text, on writing, on actual writing, but it was based on colors. The mix-up of colors made words. So you could see these blendings, rainbow, psychedelic, fantastic blendings of colors, and these were words, texts, writings. No, this is not happening in reality. But it's not even going to the bottom. Now we have Periscope. Periscope allows to send videos in real time over the internet. And what they do? How the people use Periscope? To send videos of the school teacher at school, of people bullying other people, very useless things. But it's not still the end. Another app surfaced in a few weeks ago. It's called Fling. It's beautiful. Fling is a fantastic idea. Maybe the guy or the girl that made it had a vision. You can send stuff to 50 people all around the world, and you don't know who receives this. So it's fantastic. You should send subversions proclaims. You could receipts for the revolution. You could send anything, beautiful things, desires, emotions, something great. No! The people that is using Fling, what to do? I wanted to show it to you, but now it's too complicated. People using Fling, what they send? Selfies, sometimes a video of something moving around for 5 seconds because it talks, you spend the connection. So very useless videos. People masturbating. Selfies. This is the society of karaoke. Everyone is an actor, everyone is a star, but everyone is a star of nothing. So once again, we are all zombies, but we are cyborg zombies. We are cyborgs of our technology. Anarchy was written. Create anarchy. Have you seen it? Create anarchy was written on the t-shirt. What is this? Do it yourself. Create anarchy. No one is creating anarchy anymore. Everyone is creating is 2 seconds of popularity. Even another visionary, Andy Warhol, he failed. He was too ahead of his time, and he failed. You know, every time, this is intrusive, and it gives us nothing useful. So the point is that, if we are zombies, and there is a Marxist analysis on the phenomenon of the zombies, first, we are waiting for the apocalypse to come. We are looking for the apocalypse to come because our society is broken. Our society is gone. Our life is gone. We are poor and poor and poor every day. We are losing our jobs. We cannot find the love anymore. The quality of life is degrading every day. Everywhere, politics means just corruption. We are going towards the complete disaster. And so we like zombies because this is the solution, the end of the world. And then you are freed of this. And the second idea is that zombies are all the people, as I said before, all the people that takes legal drugs, even what is the name of the most used pill when you have any kind of age? What is this? The aspirina. Even aspirin contains opium. Even aspirin is a hard drug. Try to keep aspirin 3 days away for 2 weeks and see what happens. And see what happens. You are addicted. So the zombies, it's us. And the people that is surviving to the zombies is a little group that is fighting aimlessly. But we have to solve all this. And since I don't want to be negative, I decided that we have to find a solution. Is ontological rebellion. We have been told for years that there is a right and left, right politics, left politics. We have been told that our society is a binary society. There are males, there are females. There are politically correct and politically incorrect. There is right and wrong. And it didn't work. The history that we know, the written history, goes back 6,000 years. In this 6,000 years, there were only little touches of anarchy, of liberation, of freedom. In these 6,000 years, the Berlusconis of the world already dominated. The revolution never happened and they never won. The power won. So one day I had a drug trip with very, very, very good psychedelic weed. And I understood everything. And this thing is called Va. Va means, you know, up and down, plus or less. Male or female, everything exists because its contrary exists. So we have aware of sweet because we know bitter. We have aware of love because we have experienced hate. We have aware of something because we know the contrary of this thing. So I got this idea. The word is something that is revolving. But I don't want to make it long. It's not like Vico, you know, Giambattista Vico, talking about the returning things. It's not like that. Va is not even like Tao. It's the contrary of Tao. You know Taoism. In Taoism, you know the symbol of Taoism. In Taoism, they say that in everything, there is a little bit of its contrary, of her contrary. But Taoism says that to live a perfect and beautiful and serene and happy life, you have to find the median way between these things. You have to find the gray area between black and white. You have to find medianity, mediocrity. Va says the contrary, says let's take the good things of the two opposites. Let's take violence, the interesting part of violence, and let's take the interesting part of sweetness. Let's fight the concept of male and female. Let's fight the concept of correct and incorrect. Let's bring it back. Let's bring psychedelic reality. We have to live as new cyborgs that take reality and transform in something psychedelic. We have nothing to lose. No one pretends males to have short hair and females to have long hair. And all the social, psychological oppression that we accept, but if we refuse, we don't lose nothing, but we gain our freedom. So what I say is, va, find your way and hack reality. Be a cyborg of reality, hack it. So let's just say it with me. Let's say, fight reality.
Fight reality.
Fight reality. Psychedelia.
Va.
Once again, fight reality. Psychedelia. Va. Let's learn to be free. We have to do it. Let's use everything. All the things that are politically incorrect, all the things that are negative. Let's take the good things from fascism, the good things from communism, the good things of everywhere. And let's create ourselves as cyborgs for the new generation. Helena Velena, va!
So, what do we do now? I was thinking, tough responsibility now to go on. So actually, I decide to retreat a bit myself as moderator because I think there is a great energy already flowing. So I don't want to do my question to them and I leave to the public because I think I really want to know if you share this vision, what you think about, what is your impression and emotion after all of this? Please use the microphone.
I just want to say that we don't think about it. We just leave it. I think it's just true. I don't know. It's just that.
Hi, two questions. One to Janez. First of all, one of the questions which came up among us is, have you considered a female Janez? That was the first question. And the second one, because I won't be hogging the mic for too long, I'm thinking lately about this concept of digitization from, it's original meaning, I would say. And I think it corresponds very well to what we're trying to do in this panel or this event of trying to reconsider the virtual concept of identity with the physical ones. And this is going to be slightly long, but I hope not too long. Basically, digital comes from digital, the finger, or something that you can calculate, but at the same time, it's also tactile, something that you can touch with your finger. And in a sense, I would say if you consider that definition of digitization, you would say that media was digital before the 20th century. The media that we would use physically, we would touch it. And then there came like this moment in which everything became virtual. That would be the cinema, photography, television era. I'm really simplifying this. But you talking about hacking reality or disrupting reality and going back to this I don't know, trying to counter that. And I'm thinking that, in a sense, this is kind of what is happening to us, that, in a sense, the system is corrupting our sense of reality because of what it is doing right now. It is digitizing the virtual. It is creating these gadgets which we could tactile, in a tactile manner, affect the virtual, but it is still virtual, so we're becoming even more confused, in a sense. And the reason why I'm asking this, or suggesting this thought, is because the first presentation that we had, there was a lot of discussion about Cronenberg, Videodrome, and the new publication, and it's kind of a polarity. There was the virtual dealing with, you know, Videodrome is basically television-oriented, the virtual medium, and now we're in this tactile moment. And you introduced a couple of transitions, a couple of characters which go through this. And what was lacking to me was really this pausing on this concept of redigitization, retactileability, retangibility of media. And I was wondering, I guess this question is addressed to you, if you've considered that as well, and not just staying on the level of virtual online identity, but how does physicality affect this? Have we understood my question, or was that completely... What?
12 questions.
What?
It's great, but
okay. 12
questions.
Yeah, so I will sum it down. First of all, have you considered a female Janez? And second, yeah, how about the physical? Sorry about that long one.
My answer but is very quick and simple. Yes, I did. If I were German and living in Slovenia, I would be Angela Merkel.
About hacking reality, I wanted to explain one thing, that when I use the word reality, it doesn't mean only the world of the human being abstracted from everything else. The use of technology, of this kind of technology that we have, that we are doing now, is reality. So what we have to hack now is not digital art, because digital art is already a form of hacking. We have to hack the reality of this use of technology, because this is not anymore the dream that these people and also Caronia had. And just a little other thing I want to add. When many years ago, the book from... I forgot the name. Donna Haraway was published in Italy. Many people said, wow, great, fantastic, that's the way to go. And especially the feminist movement embraced it. Then, when they started to make presentations of the book and to make conferences, they understood that the people didn't like that, the feminists didn't like that. So it was banned, it was canceled from history. Now in Italy, no one remembers that book anymore, and in this scene, the feminist scene that was the one that had to learn more from this, because Donna Haraway, that was not a young 18-year-old cyberpunk raver with purple hair from New York City, but she was a middle-aged woman living in the mountains in I don't remember where, in the mountains in the United States with cats and dogs and cows. She was the revolution. She was already saying, let's hack reality, let's hack your body, let's hack our life as a woman. But the women, they weren't ready. So now is the moment to try again, because now everything is going down the drain. So for this reason, as I said, we have nothing to lose. So let's do whatever we want to do. Like to say, don't dream it, be it, because we have got nothing to lose.
About your the digital thing you were talking about, no? Are you talking about the fact that you have a touch, that you're talking about the sense, no? Okay, so
what I've been doing is to show that we have been cyborg even before the arrival of the digital technologies. And for example, with television, no, you have the sight, the eyes, that is more involved than the contact, maybe, no? So the idea in this going through all these different characters was to show how we have cyborg, being cyborg is in every space of our life. It doesn't depend on the use of digital technology. And if we want to talk about the touch of the sense, I don't find it really specific of digital technology. I don't think that it's really about the feeling of the touch. It's just by chance that until now we use the finger, but the view, I think the human desire is to go to use just the movement of the brain. So I don't see digital technology really connected to the touch apart from the name. So, but I don't know if I reply.
Yeah, that's the response.
No, I was just like answering very briefly before because I wanted to make it short, but if I want to just maybe elaborate a little bit more on this, because I understand the point of his question. I think that in this, let's call it gesture, operation of name change, the question is not the gender, but the question is the signifier, you know, and if there were probably a personality or persona of a female gender that would be the correspondent of the Janez Janša, probably I wouldn't mind, because it's not an issue of maintaining a male name or here the name is really seen as an interface and a signifier, purely in that sense, without gender connotation. Obviously, there are some circumstances that brought to that choice, but basically, that's my answer.
Yeah. Other questions?
Hi, I have a question for Ms. Helena. So, as far as I understood from your talk, you referred to the system as a complex of negative forces controlling us as zombies, right? And you also referred to Instagram, Facebook, and so forth, these maleficial forces controlling us, right? This is your opinion. Okay, I want to share a different view and a less personal one. Let's take this simple example. We have an aquarium, right? We have water in it, we move it around, we see the water moves. Those are basically forces. It's gravity, momentum, inertia, and so forth. Think about our society as a system, as an organism, governed by forces. But these forces are unseen, such as information, such as social conditions. And all these forces generate like both negative and positive aspects. As I don't think there is anybody in control. There's no malefic entity that tries. It's just a matter of behavior according to the forces. And you judged people about Facebook, Instagram posting stupid stuff. Well, the thing is about, it's about having discipline. You have this technology, we have nuclear power, we have this. It's all about discipline, about being aware of its power and being aware that we are in control. Living in fear will stop us from progressing. If we don't think we are in control, we will always like fight with this imaginary foe. So, do you agree with my view or you think it's...
Yes, so we are in control and no one is controlling us. This is because, I mean, history repeats itself, but not always in the same way, because the bowl of Va turns in these directions, but it turns also in the other one. So, for example, many things that a couple of decades ago, like bio stuff, like to say bio food, biological food, was something that was part of the underground culture. Being vegetarian, being vegan, was part of the underground culture. Now, if you go to the biggest hotels, of the biggest corporations, they offer you biological food, vegan food, they offer you female rooms with goodies and services, especially for females. So it means that in these rotations, things changed in a way which no one was controlling. It was just happening. So that's the reason for I say that we have to go in control of ourselves and find all the things, even if in doing something that is wrong, we are running the risk of Europe falling under Islamic rule. We are really risking this. Maybe I will fight for this because I will be killed immediately because of my ideas, my way of dressing, because I'm a transgender person. I will be killed. But probably this is what history goes around. So I have to try to find means of controlling and fighting this situation. But it's not anymore part of the left wing way of thinking. We have to find different ways, looking for possibilities, energies, ideas everywhere, and also mutate everything and mutate our bodies. So, I mean, this is putting, as Antonio Caronia wanted, putting science fiction in our everyday life. Because science fiction is not only science fiction. At the time of An Ambiguous Utopia, they started to use a different meaning of S and F, and started to call it speculative fiction. So it meant that science was not so important anymore, but it was important to try to understand psychologically, emotionally, what was going on. That was for biopolitics started to exist.
May I add something? So your proposal to fighting this kind of system is anarchy. My proposal is a bit different. My proposal is about understanding the system, understanding its forces, and manipulating these forces in your own interest or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
So it doesn't have to be necessarily we need to destabilize the system in order to create our own way. We don't need a second opinion about that.
But in a way, there is no real, we call it system, we call it power, but there is no real power. When I used to sing in a punk band, my historical punk band at the time, that was called Rough Punk, like the German Rough, the Rote Armee Fraktion, Rote Armee Fraktion Punk, and we toured Germany, and there was a record label called Rockorama, that then we discovered that it was a fascist label, that they wanted to make an album with us just because of our name, and we refused to do this. But with the Rote Armee Fraktion Punk, we had a song that said, we are a minority oppressed by a majority, that is the wall of the people, repressed by a minority. So the system is not binary, it's much more complicated than that. And we have to find a way in everything.
So now, and you are going away? Tagging us. While she's tagging people, I would say, do you have something to comment? No. Helena, is okay if we go on, if there is still another question? Okay. I would say the last question. Who?
I might just be bringing down the room here. I'm the only person thinking this, but my grandmother is Muslim, and I found that kind of offensive. So.
No, but. Maybe she should answer to that. So, Helena, okay. But do you have other comments about this? I mean, you understood the criticism? Ah, okay, so could you repeat, please?
Yeah, I was just saying that I'm not sure if I'm the only person in the room thinking this, but my grandmother is Muslim, or was Muslim, she's dead. And so that's my heritage, you know, even though I look white. And it was pretty offensive what you said about Islam, to me, personally.
Actually, I don't like what Islam stands for, but I'm starting to be very fascinated of what Islamic State stands for. Because they are two things, the Islamic State of the Black Caliph, they are two things. They are first a criminal organization that is dealing with all our governments, Turkey first, but also Italy, Germany, United States, and everyone of the powerful countries of the West that have interests of them existing. So first they are a criminal organization sending gasoline, sending the historical goods that they pretend to destroy, but they are not destroying, even if in a smaller part. But the second thing is that Islamic State is speaking to the belly of the people, is speaking to the dispossessed of our time. I mean, the newspapers here in Europe, they try to let us believe that the people that escapes and goes to fight for the Islamic State are crazy people. It's not true. It's whole families with the children going there. And this is because they are speaking to the poor people, to the dispossessed people, to the people that has got nothing to lose. They are va, they are an hybrid. They took communism, even if the allegiance of these Wahhabite organizations in the history, they were with Hitler and the fascists. But they took communism, they took capitalism, they took even the black bloc aesthetic, they took it, everything they wanted. They are doing a va project. So we have to find our way to destabilize the Wa project with our own Wa project. Apart with this, Muslim people, it's okay, no problem. Still, I am an atheist, so I believe firmly, since I am an anarchist, you know, no God, no master, no God comes first. So for me, there is no God, but then if someone else wants to believe in this, okay, but now, if you talk about Islam, you have to take in account Islamic State.
Yeah, I would say this is a really tricky conversation. Maybe we should do another conference about that. Because, you know, speaking about Muslim is not the same as speaking about Islam. That is not the same as speaking about the Islamic State. But, I mean, this is really complex conversation that I would not start now. And I would say that we are running a bit over time, so I'm happy to conclude the first day of the CYBORG event and also invite everybody to our after conference at Vierte Welt Kollaborationen, that is in Kottbusser Tor at the first floor where there is the Kreuzberg Zentrum. And then I would like really to thank Helena Velena, Janez Janša and Agnese Trocchi for this great panel. And besides inviting all of you at the after conference, in which we'll also have an open microphone, so if you also feel to say your thoughts, because we really throw a lot of concept today, I think it would be great to hear your voice again. And then we come back here tomorrow at 4 with the keynotes about cyber feminists and beyond of Francesca da Rimini and Virginia Barrett. Thank you very much.
Fantastica, sei fantastica, sei fantastica.